Béla Bartók, Béla Viktor János Bartók, March 25, 1881, September 26, 1945, was a Hungarian composer, pianist, and ethnomusicologist. He is considered one of the most important composers of the 20th century. He and Liszt are regarded as Hungary's greatest composers. Through his collection and analytical study of folk music, he was one of the founders of comparative musicology, which later became ethnomusicology. Bartók was born in the Banatian town of Nagyszentmiklós in the Kingdom of Hungary, Austria-Hungary, since 1920 Sânnicolau Mare, Romania, on 25 March 1881. Bartók had a diverse ancestry. On his father's side, the Bartók family was a Hungarian lower noble family, originating from Borsodszirák, Borsod. Although his paternal grandmother was from a Catholic Serbian family, Bartók's father, also named Béla, considered himself to be an ethnic-born Hungarian. Béla Bartók's mother, Paula, névoit, an ethnic German, spoke Hungarian fluently. She was a native of Tersinski Svati Martin, now Martin, Slovakia. Paula also had Magyar, Teres Fijavirs, and Slavic, Polrekski, Magyarized Slavic, ancestors. Béla displayed notable musical talent very early in life. According to his mother, he could distinguish between different dance rhythms that she played on the piano before he learned to speak in complete sentences. By the age of 4 he was able to play 40 pieces on the piano and his mother began formally teaching him the next year. Béla was a small and sickly child and suffered from severe eczema until the age of 5. In 1888, when he was 7, his father, the director of an agricultural school, died suddenly. His mother then took him and his sister, Erzsébet, to live in Nagyszentmiklós, today Vinogradov, Ukraine, and then to Posseny, present-day Bratislava, Slovakia. He gave his first public recital aged 11 in Nagyszentmiklós, to a warm critical reception. Among the pieces he played was his own first composition, written 2 years previously, a short piece called The Course of the Danube. Shortly thereafter László Erkel accepted him as a pupil. From 1899 to 1903, Bartók studied piano under Ezt von Thoman, a former student of Franz Liszt, and composition under János Kozler at the Royal Academy of Music in Budapest. There he met Zoltán Kodály, who made a strong impression on him and became a lifelong friend and colleague. In 1903, Bartók wrote his first major orchestral work, Kossuth, a symphonic poem which honored Lajos Kossuth, hero of the Hungarian Revolution of 1848. The music of Richard Strauss, whom he met in 1902 at the Budapest premiere of Also Sprach Zarathustra, strongly influenced his early work. When visiting a holiday resort in the summer of 1904, Bartók overheard a young nanny, Lydia Doza from Kibden, Transylvania, sing folk songs to the children in her care. This sparked his lifelong dedication to folk music. From 1907, he also began to be influenced by the French composer Claude Debussy, whose compositions Kodály had brought back from Paris. Bartók's large-scale orchestral works were still in the style of Johannes Brahms and Richard Strauss, but he wrote a number of small piano pieces which showed his growing interest in folk music. The first piece to show clear signs of this new interest is the String Quartet No. 1 in A minor, 1908, which contains folk-like elements. In 1907, Bartók began teaching as a piano professor at the Royal Academy. This position freed him from touring Europe as a pianist and enabled him to work in Hungary. Among his notable students were Fritz Reiner, Sergei Orcholti, Jurich Sandor, Ernő Balog, and Lily Krauss. After Bartók moved to the United States, he taught Jack Beeson and Violet Archer. In 1908, he and Kodály traveled into the countryside to collect and research old Magyar folk melodies. Their growing interest in folk music coincided with a contemporary social interest in traditional national culture. They made some surprising discoveries. Magyar folk music had previously been categorized as gypsy music. The classic example is Franz Liszt's famous Hungarian Rhapsodies for Piano, which he based on popular art songs performed by Romani bands of the time. In contrast, Bartók and Kodály discovered that the old Magyar folk melodies were based on pentatonic scales, similar to those in Asian folk traditions, such as those of Central Asia, Anatolia, and Siberia. Bartók and Kodály quickly set about incorporating elements of such Magyar peasant music into their compositions. They both frequently quoted folk song melodies verbatim and wrote pieces derived entirely from authentic songs. An example is his two volumes entitled For Children for Solo Piano, containing 80 folk tunes to which he wrote accompaniment. Bartók's style in his art music compositions was a synthesis of folk music, classicism, and modernism. His melodic and harmonic sense was profoundly influenced by the folk music of Hungary, Romania, and other nations. He was especially fond of the asymmetrical dance rhythms and pungent harmonies found in Bulgarian music. Most of his early compositions offer a blend of nationalist and late Romanticism elements. In 1909, at the age of 28, Bartók married Marta Ziegler, 1893-1967, aged 16. Their son, Béla Bartók III, was born on August 22, 1910. After nearly 15 years together, Bartók divorced Marta in June 1923. 2 months after his divorce, he married Dita Pastori, 1903-1982, a piano student, 10 days after proposing to her. She was aged 19, he 42. Their son, Petr, was born in 1924. In 1911, Bartók wrote what was to be his only opera, Bluebeard's Castle, dedicated to Marta. He entered it for a prize by the Hungarian Fine Arts Commission, but they rejected his work as not fit for the stage. In 1917, Bartók revised the score for the 1918 premiere, and rewrote the ending. Following the 1919 revolution in which he actively participated, he was pressured by the Horthy regime to remove the name of the librettist Béla Balázs from the opera, as he was blacklisted and had left the country for Vienna. Bluebeard's Castle received only one revival, in 1936, before Bartók emigrated. For the remainder of his life, although he was passionately devoted to Hungary, its people and its culture, he never felt much loyalty to the government or its official establishments. After his disappointment over the Fine Arts Commission competition, Bartók wrote little for 2 or 3 years, preferring to concentrate on collecting and arranging folk music. He collected first in the Carpathian Basin, then the Kingdom of Hungary, where he notated Hungarian, Slovak, Romanian, and Bulgarian folk music. He also collected in Moldavia, Wallachia, and, in 1913, Algeria. The outbreak of World War I forced him to stop the expeditions, and he returned to composing, writing the ballet The Wooden Prince, 1914-16, and the String Quartet No. 2 in 1915-17, both influenced by Debussy. Raised as a Catholic, by his early adulthood Bartók had become an atheist. He later became attracted to Unitarianism and publicly converted to the Unitarian faith in 1916. Although Bartók was not conventionally religious, according to his son Béla Bartók III, he was a nature lover. He always mentioned the miraculous order of nature with great reverence. As an adult, Béla III later became lay president of the Hungarian Unitarian Church. Bartók wrote another ballet, The Miraculous Mandarin, influenced by Igor Stravinsky, Arnold Schoenberg, as well as Richard Strauss. A modern story of prostitution, robbery, and murder, it was started in 1918, but not performed until 1926 because of its sexual content. He next wrote his two violin sonatas, written in 1921 and 1922 respectively, which are harmonically and structurally some of his most complex pieces. In 1927-28, Bartók wrote his third and fourth string quartets, after which his compositions demonstrated his mature style. Notable examples of this period are Music for Strings, Percussion and Celesta, 1936, and Divertimento for String Orchestra, 1939. The fifth string quartet was composed in 1934, and the sixth string quartet, his last, in 1939. In 1936 he traveled to Turkey to collect and study folk music. He worked in collaboration with Turkish composer Ahmet Adnan Saygun mostly around Adana. In 1940, as the European political situation worsened after the outbreak of World War II, Bartók was increasingly tempted to flee Hungary. He was strongly opposed to the Nazis and Hungary's siding with Germany. After the Nazis came to power in the early 1930s, Bartók refused to give concerts in Germany and broke away from his publisher there. His anti-fascist political views caused him a great deal of trouble with the establishment in Hungary. Having first sent his manuscripts out of the country, Bartók reluctantly emigrated to the U.S. with his wife Dita in October that year. They settled in New York City after arriving on the night of 29 October 30, 1940 via steamer from Lisbon. After joining them in 1942, their younger son, Petr Bartók, enlisted in the United States Navy where he served in the Pacific during the remainder of the war and later settled in Florida where he became a recording and sound engineer. His elder son, by his first marriage, Béla Bartók III, remained in Hungary and later worked as a railroad official until his retirement in the early 1980s. Although he became an American citizen in 1945, shortly before his death, Bartók never felt fully at home in the USA. He initially found it difficult to compose. Although he was well known in America as a pianist, ethnomusicologist and teacher, he was not well known as a composer. There was little American interest in his music during his final years. He and his wife Dita gave some concerts, although demand for them was low. Bartók, who had made some recordings in Hungary, also recorded for Columbia Records after he came to the U.S. Many of these recordings, some with Bartók's own spoken introductions, were later issued on LP and CD. Supported by a research fellowship from Columbia University, for several years, Bartók and Dita worked on a large collection of Serbian and Croatian folk songs in Columbia's libraries. Bartók's economic difficulties during his first years in America were mitigated by publication royalties, teaching and performance tours. While his finances were always precarious, he did not live and die in poverty as was the common myth. He had enough friends and supporters to ensure that there was sufficient money and work available for him to live on. Bartók was a proud man and did not easily accept charity. Despite being short on cash at times, he often refused money that his friends offered him out of their own pockets. Although he was not a member of the ASCAP, the society paid for any medical care he needed during his last 2 years. Bartók reluctantly accepted this. The first symptoms of his health problems began late in 1940, when his right shoulder began to show signs of stiffening. In 1942, symptoms increased and he started having bouts of fever, but no underlying disease was diagnosed, in spite of medical examinations. Finally, in April 1944, leukemia was diagnosed, but by this time, little could be done. As his body slowly failed, Bartók found more creative energy, and he produced a final set of masterpieces, partly thanks to the violinist Joseph Szigeti and the conductor Fritz Reiner. Reiner had been Bartók's friend and champion since his days as Bartók's student at the Royal Academy. Bartók's last work might well have been the String Quartet No. 6, but for Serge Koussevitzky's commission for the Concerto for Orchestra. Koussevitzky's Boston Symphony Orchestra premiered the work in December 1944 to highly positive reviews. The Concerto for Orchestra quickly became Bartók's most popular work, although he did not live to see its full impact. In 1944, he was also commissioned by Yehudi Menuhin to write a sonata for solo violin. In 1945, Bartók composed his Piano Concerto No. 3, a graceful and almost neoclassical work, as a surprise 42nd birthday present for Dita, but he died just over a month before her birthday, with the scoring not quite finished. He had also sketched his Viola Concerto, but had barely started the scoring at his death, leaving completed only the viola part and sketches of the orchestral part. Béla Bartók died at age 64 in a hospital in New York City from complications of leukemia, specifically, of secondary polycythemia, on September 26, 1945. His funeral was attended by only 10 people. Among them were his wife Dita, their son Petr, and his pianist friend George Sándor. Bartók's body was initially interred in Ferncliff Cemetery in Hartsdale, New York. During the final year of communist Hungary in late 1980s, the Hungarian government, along with his two sons, Béla III and Petr, requested that his remains be exhumed and transferred back to Budapest for burial, where Hungary arranged a state funeral for him on July 7, 1988. He was reinterred at Budapest's Farkasréti Cemetery, next to the remains of Dita, who died in 1982, the year after his centenary. The two unfinished works were later completed by his pupil Tibor Serli. George Sándor was the soloist in the first performance of the third piano concertune February 8, 1946. Dita Pastori Bartók later played and recorded it. The viola concerto was revised and published in the 1990s by Bartók's son, Peter. This version may be closer to what Bartók intended. Concurrently, Peter Bartók, in association with Argentinian musician Nelson Del Maggior, worked to reprint and revise past editions of the third piano concerto. Bartók's music reflects two trends that dramatically changed the sound of music in the 20th century: the breakdown of the diatonic system of harmony thought that served composers for the previous 200 years, and the revival of nationalism as a source for musical inspiration, a trend that began with Mikhail Glinka and Antonín Dvořák in the last half of the 19th century. In his search for new forms of tonality, Bartók turned to Hungarian folk music, as well as to other folk music of the Carpathian Basin and even of Algeria and Turkey. In so doing, he became influential in that stream of modernism which exploited indigenous music and techniques. One characteristic style of music is his night music, which he used mostly in slow movements of multi-movement ensemble or orchestral compositions in his mature period. It is characterized by eerie dissonances providing a backdrop to sounds of nature and lowly melodies. An example is the third movement, Adagio, of his music for strings, percussion and celesta. His music can be grouped roughly in accordance with the different periods in his life. The works of Bartók's youth were written in a classical and early romantic style touched with influences of popular and gypsy music. Between 1890 and 1894, 9 to 13 years of age, he wrote 31 piano pieces with corresponding opus numbers. Although most of these were simple dance pieces, in these early works Bartók began to tackle some more advanced forms, as in his 10-part programmatica Dunafoyasa, The Course of the Danube, 1890-94, which he played in his first public recital in 1892. In Catholic grammar school, Bartók took to studying the scores of composers from Bach to Wagner, his compositions now advancing in style and taking on similarities to Schumann and Brahms. Following his matriculation into the Budapest Academy in 1890, he composed very little, though he began to work one exercises in orchestration and familiarized himself thoroughly with the operas of Wagner. In 1902, his creative energies were revitalized by the discovery of the music of Richard Strauss, whose tone poem Also Sprach Zarathustra, according to Bartók, stimulated the greatest enthusiasm in me. At last I saw the white that lay before me. Bartók also owned the score to A Hero's Life, which he transcribed for the piano and committed to memory. Under the influence of Strauss, Bartók composed in 1903 Kossuth, a symphonic poem in 10 tableaus on the subject of the 1848 Hungarian War of Independence, reflecting the composer's growing interest in musical nationalism. A year later he renewed his opus numbers with the Rhapsody for Piano and Orchestra serving as Opus 1. Driven by nationalistic fervor and a desire to transcend the influence of prior composers, Bartók began a lifelong devotion to folk music which was sparked by his overhearing Nanny Liddy Doze's singing of Transylvanian folk songs at a Hungarian resort in 1904. Bartók began to collect Magyar peasant melodies, later extending to the folk music of other peoples of the Carpathian Basin. His compositional output would gradually prune away romantic elements in favor of an idiom that embodied folk music as intrinsic and essential to its style. Later in life he would have this to say on the incorporation of folk and art music. The question is, what are the ways in which peasant music is taken over and becomes transmuted into modern music? We may, for instance, take over a peasant melody unchanged or only slightly varied, write an accompaniment to it and possibly some opening and concluding phrases. This kind of work would show a certain analogy with Bach's treatment of chorales. Another method is the following: the composer does not make use of a real peasant melody but invents his own imitation of such melodies. There is no true difference between this method and the one described above. There is yet a third way: neither peasant melodies nor imitations of peasant melodies can be found in his music, but it is pervaded by the atmosphere of peasant music. In this case we may say, he has completely absorbed the idiom of peasant music which has become his musical mother tongue. Bartók became first acquainted with Debussy's music in 1907 and regarded his music highly. In an interview in 1939 Bartók said, Debussy's great service to music was to reawaken among all musicians an awareness of harmony and its possibilities. In that, he was just as important as Beethoven, who revealed to us the possibilities of progressive form, or as Bach, who showed us the transcendent significance of counterpoint. Now, what I am always asking myself is this: is it possible to make a synthesis of these three great masters, a living synthesis that will be valid for our time? Debussy's influence is present in the 14 Bagatelles, 1908. These made Ferruccio Busoni exclaim at last something truly new. Until 1911, Bartók composed widely differing works which ranged from adherence to romantic style, to folk song arrangements and to his modernist opera Bluebeard's Castle. The negative reception of his work led him to focus on folk music research after 1911 and abandon composition with the exception of folk music arrangements. His pessimistic attitude towards composing was lifted by the stormy and inspiring contact with Clara Gombasi in the summer of 1915. This interesting episode in Bartók's life remained hidden until it was researched by Janai Still between 1979 and 1989. Bartók started composing again, including the suite for piano Opus 14, 1916, and the Miraculous Mandarin, 1918, and he completed the Wooden Prince, 1917. Bartók felt the result of World War I as a personal tragedy. Many regions he loved were severed from Hungary, Transylvania, the Banat where he was born, and Posen where his mother lived. Additionally, the political relations between Hungary and the other successor states to the Austro-Hungarian Empire prohibited his folk music research outside of Hungary. Bartók also wrote the noteworthy 8 improvisations on Hungarian peasant songs in 1920, and the Sunny Dance Suite in 1923, the year of his second marriage. In 1926, Bartók needed a significant piece for piano and orchestra with which he could tour in Europe and America. In the preparation for writing his first piano concerto, he wrote his sonata, Out of Doors, and 9 little pieces, all for solo piano. He increasingly found his own voice in his maturity. The style of his last period, named Synthesis of East and West, is hard to define, let alone to put under one term. In his mature period, Bartók wrote relatively few works, but most of them are large-scale compositions for large settings. Only his voice works have programmatic titles, and his late works often adhere to classical forms. Among his masterworks are all the 6-string quartets, 1908, 1917, 1927, 1928, 1934, and 1939, the Cantata Profana, 1930. Bartók declared that this was the work he felt and professed to be his most personal credo, the Music for Strings, Percussion and Celesta, 1936, the Concerto for Orchestra, 1943, and the Third Piano Concerto, 1945. Bartók also made a lasting contribution to the literature for younger students. For his son Peter's music lessons, he composed Mikrokosmos, a 6-volume collection of graded piano pieces. Paul Wilson lists as the most prominent characteristics of Bartók's music from late 1920s onwards the influence of the Carpathian Basin and European art music, and his changing attitude toward, and use of, tonality, but without the use of the traditional harmonic functions associated with major and minor scales. Although Bartók claimed in his writings that his music was always tonal, he rarely uses the chords or scales of tonality, and so the descriptive resources of tonal theory are of limited use. George and Elliott focus on alternative methods of signaling tonal centers, via axes of inversional symmetry. Others view Bartók's axes of symmetry in terms of 8 tonal analytic protocols. Richard argues that inversional symmetry is often a byproduct of another atonal procedure, the formation of chords from transpositionally related dyads. Atonal pitch class theory also furnishes the resources for exploring polymodal chromaticism, projected sets, privileged patterns, and large set types used as source sets, such as the equal-tempered 12-tone aggregate, octatonic scale, and alpha chord, the diatonic and heptatoniasic unto 7-note scales, and less often the whole tone scale and the primary pentatonic collection. He rarely used the simple aggregate actively to shape musical structure, though there are notable examples such as the second theme from the first movement of his second violin concerto, commenting that he wanted to show Schoenberg that one can use all 12 tones and still remain tonal. More thoroughly, in the first 8 measures of the last movement of his second quartet, all notes gradually gather with the 12th, G, sounding for the first time on the last beat of measure 8, marking the end of the first section. The aggregate is partitioned in the opening of the 3rd string quartet with CDDI in the accompaniment, strings, while the remaining pitch classes are used in the melody, violin 1, and more often as 7-35, diatonic or white key collection and 5-35, pentatonic or black key collection, such as in number 6 of the 8 improvisations. There, the primary theme is on the black keys in the left hand, while the right accompanies with triads from the white keys. In measures 50-51 in the 3rd movement of the 4th quartet, the first violin and cello play black key chords, while the second violin and viola play stepwise diatonic lines. On the other hand, from as early as the suite for piano, Opus 14, 1914, he occasionally employed a form of serialism based on compound interval cycles, some of which are maximally distributed, multi-aggregate cycles. Ernu Lendvai, 1971, analyzes Bartók's works as being based on 2 opposing tonal systems, that of the acoustic scale and the axis system, as well as using the golden section as a structural principle. Milton Babbitt, in his 1949 critique of Bartók's string quartets, criticized Bartók for using tonality and non-tonal methods unique to each piece. Babbitt noted that Bartók's solution was a specific one, it cannot be duplicated. Bartók's use of two organizational principles, tonality for large-scale relationships and the piece-specific method for moment-to-moment thematic elements, was a problem for Babbitt, who worried that the highly attenuated tonality requires extreme non-harmonic methods to create a feeling of closure. The cataloging of Bartók's works is somewhat complex. Bartók assigned opus numbers to his works three times, the last of these series ending with the Sonata for Violin and Piano No. 1, Opus 21 in 1921. He ended this practice because of the difficulty of distinguishing between original works and ethnographic arrangements, and between major and minor works. Since his death, three attempts, two full and one partial, have been made at cataloging. The first, and still most widely used, is András Szalosi's chronological SC. Numbers, from 1 to 121. Danige still subsequently reorganized the Juvenilia, SC.1 to 25, thematically, as DD numbers 1 to 77. The most recent catalog is that of László Szumpfy. This is a chronological index with works identified by BB numbers 1 to 129, incorporating corrections based on the Béla Bartók thematic catalog. On January 1, 2016, his works entered the public domain in the European Union. Together with his like-minded contemporary Zoltán Kodály, Bartók embarked on an extensive program of field research to capture the folk and peasant melodies of Magyar, Slovak and Romanian language territories. At first they would transcribe the melodies by hand, but later they began to use a wax cylinder recording machine invented by Thomas Edison. Compilations of Bartók's field recordings, interviews, and original piano playing have been released over the years, largely by the Hungarian record label Hungarotan. A compilation of field recordings and transcriptions for two violas was also recently released by Tantara Records in 2014. On March 18, 2016, Decca Classics released Béla Bartók, The Complete Works, the first ever complete compilation of all of Bartók's compositions, including new recordings of never before recorded early piano and vocal works. However, none of the composer's own performances are included in this 32-disc set. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.